Hello, everyone. Hi. Not quite sure how to follow Alice there. That was absolutely phenomenal. But I guess we'll try. My name is James. I'm from Animal Rebellion. For those that aren't aware, Animal Rebellion is a mass movement that utilizes nonviolent civil disobedience in order to bring about a transition to a just and sustainable plant-based food system in order to halt mass extinction, alleviate the worst effects of climate breakdown, and ensure justice for animals. Thank God I got through that. That's taken 2 years to almost memorize. In order to do that, we utilize a variety of tactics, direct action amongst more traditional campaigning practices, in order to pressure governments, corporations, and generally raise awareness in the general public about the damaging effects of animal agriculture and the fishing industries, and ultimately relegate it to the history books where it belongs. So we're gonna play a little movie about some of the things that we've done recently, and then we'll introduce the panel.
They are a symbol of the meat industry, they're a symbol of animal agriculture, and they are a symbol for what we're doing to our planet. They are causing millions of acres of deforestation in the Amazon. They are paying people low wages and in really terrible working environments. They are killing literally millions, or if not billions, of animals worldwide. They're a symbol of the system that we're in, and they're a symbol of how we treat the planet and other beings.
We're just in a massive crisis right now, and things need to change quickly and drastically. If we can really highlight the fragility of the supply chains that we have at the moment, then we can help to make people more aware of the overall fragility of our food system at the moment.
McDonald's are causing rainforest deforestation, causing mass slaughter of animals. Animals are suffering just so that people can eat a burger. We know that animal agriculture is one of the leading causes of climate change. We're asking McDonald's to transition to a plant-based menu, and we want to put pressure on them and the CEO to actually make a decision and do the right thing.
I'm pretty nervous and I'm pretty scared, I'm pretty stressed. I feel a bit nervous that we're going to take on one of the companies that's causing the most destruction globally to the environment, to animals, and to people. I think it's about time that someone stands up and does something about it. We tried year and year again doing things that aren't disruptive and we need to get ignored. But with this action, no one can ignore it. And that is the kind of change we need everyone to start taking.
We're driving just about all kinds of life on Earth extinct. And you know, I can't sit by and watch that happen the rest of my life.
Cool. So it's been really heartwarming walking around this site, just looking at all of your incandescently beautiful, youthful skin and stuff. And it's just like, it's very tempting to just want to secede from the rest of the United Kingdom and just start our own like vegan paradise just right here. I'm up for it. However, there's a bit of a monumental clusterfuck happening out there at the moment. And I think it's going to require every one of us to do whatever we can to bring about the kind of system change that we require in the world. And that doesn't necessarily mean doing what we do. We are part of we're one strand of a very broad movement ecology, but it requires every single one of us working in whatever capacity we can to bring about the kind of change that's required. So we're gonna focus a little bit on the stuff that we do. Obviously, we're very happy if you would join us. And we're going to talk a little bit more about direct action. But before we do that, let's have the panel introduce themselves and say a little bit about what they do within Animal Rebellion.
My name's Rose. I'm part of the actions team in Animal Rebellion. I've been part of the actions team for about a year and a half now. And yeah, basically involves coming up with crazy ideas to shut down institutions and yeah, to hopefully make a change. So.
Yeah. Hey, I'm Vanya. I work in the strategy team, and I primarily work in the local council schools campaign, campaigning local councils to transition schools into 2 plant-based days a week.
Hi, I'm Miranda. I'm a bit less, I do mobilization and social media. So looking at how we can, engage the public and how we can get people on our side and kind of like the messaging we can use that is actually effective and is not going to turn people away and think that we're not, engaging or we're like an extreme movement, but actually trying to get people on our side and to realize that, the actual causes of animal agriculture. So, yeah.
Hello, thank you. Yeah, I'm Charlie. I work in a couple of teams. I work in a self-organizing system team, which helps keep the operations going on, and also a global team. So we're trying to build the movement worldwide.
Cool. So I think Rose is probably going to be the best person to enlighten us a little bit more about what is direct action, what it involves, and all of that.
I'm sure many of you know what direct action is. And just to clarify, we're talking about non-violent direct action. So we're always peaceful at all of our protests and actions. Basically, direct action means putting pressure on institutions, governments, that could be putting pressure on them socially, economically, politically, and asking them to make a change. So we're talking about system change when we're talking about animal rebellion. Methods of direct action could be sit-ins, locking on, gluing on, blockading businesses, basically preventing businesses from going about their business as usual, or it could be a business or government. So there are many ways to do this. Gene Sharp has 198 different methods of direct action. So yeah, just go have a look at that list. It's really interesting. I'm sure many of you have heard of like Direct Action Everywhere or DXE, also Meet the Victims, really good example of direct action. So they focus mainly on obviously farms, intensive farms. So Alice spoke about them earlier. So activists go into farms and are encouraged to film and share on social media what they see. And obviously it's horrendous what happens in those places. And also they often negotiate to have animals liberated as well from those farms. So that's one form of direct action. Examples of what Animal Rebellion have done. So last year we shut down Arla, the dairy distribution center in North London, for one day, and we were demanding that they transition to plant-based milk. We also told the government that they have blood on their hands, and we told them this by dyeing the fountains in Trafalgar Square red. People weren't too happy about that. And earlier this year, I feel like our actions have escalated over the past year. But yeah, earlier this year, we shut down 4 distribution sites of McDonald's, as you saw in the video below before. caused massive disruption to their supply chain, and it meant that many of their restaurants had to close for the day. They didn't respond, so we thought, we'll try again, we'll try and get reaction, and we shut down their burger factory. They've only got 1 burger factory for the whole of the UK, so we thought, it seems like an easy target. We shut that down for 3 days, and caused massive disruption to McDonald's.
Cool. Miranda, would you like to enlighten us a bit about why we utilize these sorts of tactics?
I'd like to talk briefly about the 3 main reasons why I, and I think Animal Rebellion as a movement, think that direct action, is the direction and the things that we need to be doing in this moment and against the crisis and the animal emergency that we're talking about here. So, of course, I think we all know what's happening to our planet. We know what's happening to our air and our oceans and our future and our children's futures. We just have to look across every single continent in the last few weeks or months to see what is happening. We all know this. I don't think I need to talk about that, but I think the main concern is what the government and what the corporations are or are not actually doing about that, and the things that they like to not talk about. So the impact of animal agriculture causing ocean dead zones, causing water, air pollution, causing species to go extinct, causing mass greenhouse gases, obviously specifically methane, and how this continues ticking on and ticking on and ticking on, all in the name of profit and, you know, people's wealth expansion. So in this time of extreme, you know, climate emergency, we are seeing very, very, very slow reaction and slow change from our government and from the people in power. You know, there have been great campaigns to reduce meat consumption or to reduce water waste and all these things, but we all know that these things are too slow. And unfortunately, we all often go about our business, we work, we go to uni, we learn, we try to get a job, we sign petitions, we pay our tax, we do everything. And what has it left us? What future has that left my generation and the generations of our children and our grandchildren? Direct action, we believe, is a way to increase the pressure and to show more in the public sphere the reality and to, you know, and to speak to people and to start a conversation. And secondly, we are very focused on systematic change and not individual change. And what Alice was talking about earlier, these stages of how we often feel anger, and I know I have felt this for a period of time. You feel angry at people and you want them to change. You want the change to come now. And it's very easy for you to see an individual and you want to blame them, but it really does get us nowhere. We are all earthlings on this planet, and we can only make the change if the system changes and those in power change, and if we collectively come together to make a change. And direct action is just an amazing way for you to feel empowered. And you know, these things that we see in the news and these things that we see happening to animals for decades and decades and decades, it can make us feel a whole range of emotions, often overwhelming, you know, sadness and negativity. But really, to come together and to do something, to say no to these people in suits, in their mansions, in their private jets who destroy our ecosystems, our rainforests, our beautiful fellow species, if we come together collectively to make change and feel empowered, direct action is just an amazing way to step up and say no. I'm going to use my time in whatever role that you can find in direct action to say no and to make a change. So yeah, I would really urge people to follow us, and just if you want to get involved, please do. And there's many roles that you can fill, and we'll talk about that next. Thank you.
Thanks, Miranda. It should be said that there's a lot that goes into doing this sort of thing, and it isn't a prerequisite if you want to get involved that you need to be getting arrested. For a lot of people, it has to be said that being arrested is, in a way, is a privilege. I mean, for certain demographics, it's going to be an easier process than others, unfortunately, due to the system that we live in. But the good thing about sort of what we do is that there is roles that in so many different areas, and that people can sort of engage in whatever capacity that they can. And there's a broad statistic, I don't know how accurate it is, but it takes largely 10 non-arrestable people per one arrest. So there is a huge support crew required, and basically every single one of those people is as important as the arrestable, if not more important, because they couldn't do it without them. To enlighten us a bit more about what some of those roles are and some of the different kind of tactics we as an organization take, Vani is going to tell us a bit more.
Thank you, Skeet. So there's a lot that happens behind closed doors that does not make it on these videos, but a lot of effort and hard work from all of our rebels goes into it. If you want to get involved, you could get involved on the ground by helping with well-being, by helping with de-escalation of situations that may arise, by helping with police liaison for our arrestees. You could also help if you guys have good cooking skills, help cooking during the rebellion. If you haven't heard about the rebellion is a two-week occupation of central London, starting from the 23rd of August all the way into the 4th of September. So straight from here, a bunch of animal rebels are joining other rebels in central London and occupying the streets in order to put pressure on the government to meet our demands. So there's a lot of roles that anyone over here can take on, whether you can join us on the field or not, even virtual roles, helping with social media, helping with promotion, helping with outreach in your own region, where even if you're not based in London, there's a lot of roles that you can take on. We touched upon earlier and yesterday about the local school campaign that's currently running to campaign schools to include more plant-based meals. We have 40 of those campaigns going on in different local councils, but you can also start a campaign in your local council or join your local council's team to put pressure on the MPs in that region. So really, just come and have a chat with us. We can utilize the skills that you bring to the table, be it arts, be it social media, giving talks, just being there for someone who's spending days locked in, you know, helping with well-being. So there's a role for any age, any person of color, any immigration status. Because many people can't take on arrestable roles because they're a person of color from the LGBTQ community or things like that. So we've really got a role for any age and any ability. And come have a chat with us if you want to join us in the rebellion. Yeah.
Thanks, Vania. And there's a lot that goes into the structure of Animal Rebellion and sort of a lot of the backs in sort of terms of equipping our rebels with the necessary skills that they require in order to undertake direct action. And Charlie's going to fill us in a bit more about that.
Yes, we do have talks and trainings regularly for people who have joined Animal Rebellion. So we explain to people the structure of the organization, the strategy, the story of Animal Rebellion and the culture of Animal Rebellion. And the idea of this is that everybody within the organization or within the group knows what's going on. So in order for this to happen, there are various teams that people can join. And for example, if you're good at web design, you could perhaps join a web design team. If you know about Facebook or Twitter or Instagram, people are involved with doing that, and just generally that sort of anything anyone can do, as was already said.
Awesome. Cool. So it seems weird if I'm just asking questions because I already know the answers to these. So I'm just going to open it out to a general Q&A. If you guys have got any questions, I'm going to run around with a microphone and hopefully we can answer them. Has anyone got any questions at all? Sweet, I'm going to run down there. Cool. Ugh. Sorry, I'm very unfit. Hiya.
So far, you seem to be quite like London-based. And I live in like a major city like Birmingham. Like, what's the likelihood that you guys would be able to have a headquarters like in Birmingham, and so you can like set up in major cities and make it very localized so that we don't have to like travel, we can all kind of unify, if that makes sense?
I couldn't agree more. This is actually, I'm actually from Manchester, so I've been having this conversation quite a lot about decentralization. Any of you guys want to talk about that?
I mean, like Charlie spoke about, we're trying to globalize this movement, and of course it's to move it to different places across the UK. So really, all it takes is like 3-4 of your friends to come together and start something. So if you would like to start something in Birmingham, we got you, you know, just come and talk to us and we can start a campaign there, yeah.
Cool, so we got our Birmingham group sorted. Excellent, love it. I saw another hand over there. There we go. Oh my God. Hiya.
Hello. Firstly, I just want to say it's awesome out of a panel of five people to see three young women represent, so that's really cool. And then my question is, I think earlier someone mentioned that you were hoping to get McDonald's to go plant-based by 2023. Like, what are the steps you're thinking of taking to make that happen?
Rose, you're probably best for that.
I'll try. Yeah, it's plant-based by 2025, not 2023. But yeah, we think that 2025 is quite a reasonable ask. So that would give them like 3.5 years or so. So yeah, we've seen so many other like restaurants and brands, for example, like IKEA, Wagamama. I think even Burger King have like hinted at the fact that they're going at least 50% plant-based by, I think they've said 2030. So and IKEA have already said they're going 50% plant-based by, I think it's the end of this year or next year, and the same with Wagamama's, or they might have even already done it. So if basically McDonald's haven't like committed to anything. Like they've got, I think, one vegan wrap or something. For a global brand like them, like that's just pathetic. And this is an emergency, like we need to act now. So that's why we're asking them. I mean, ideally, yeah, we'd ask them to go vegan or plant-based tomorrow, but I think 2025 is a very reasonable ask. But yeah, basically we obviously have these big actions that we're doing, like, now we've done like two big ones, but yeah, now we've got these sit-ins as well. So we call them a muck sit-in. So basically it could be done by anyone. People all over the world are already doing them and all over the UK. So it's just putting pressure on the restaurants as well as like the distribution centers basically. So what happens is a group of rebels go in, normally not wearing any Animal Rebellion paraphernalia or anything, no badges, just looking like regular McDonald's customers, go in and sit down and bring plant-based vegan food with them and sit down and normally decorate the place with some fruits, vegetables, plants, get some tablecloths out and literally sit down and have a plant-based meal in McDonald's, which might sound like a very unusual thing to do and not the nicest place to be eating food anyway for most of us. But basically it's based on during the civil rights movement in the 1960s, there were the lunch counter sit-ins. So basically there were white only lunch counters, which is like unbelievable to think about now. But yeah, that was just 50, 60 years ago or so that was still happening, and black activists would go in and literally just sit and eat, and that's all they were doing, just sitting and eating, being peaceful, and they would get aggression, they get abuse held at them, sometimes violence, and so yeah, that was kind of the inspiration for the McSittins. So all we're doing is showing, it's a visioning action basically, we're showing them what we want to see in the future, and we're asking, that's exactly what we're asking McDonald's to do, to provide plant-based food to people that is cheap and accessible. So yeah, that's like another way that we're asking. So it's not just these big actions, it's like anyone can do it anywhere. So the new Birmingham group, you can start with a McSittin. But yeah, so basically it's putting pressure on them. I think their tactic at the moment is to not respond to us, so we're trying to get a response. But yeah, we just need more and more people. We're trying to grow mass mobilization movement, and so we need people, we need all of you. Imagine if everyone here went to their hometowns like next weekend and did this. That would shut down so many restaurants, because yeah, McDonald's sometimes just shut down their restaurant when we do the McSittins basically. Sometimes they see it on Facebook and they're scared that we're all coming to, I don't know what they think we're gonna do, and then they just shut down before we even get there. So that's a win for us when they do that. So it's basically putting pressure on them, and it's also about publicity, getting this idea of a plant-based food system and a plant-based menu into the media and into the mind of the public as well, because like it should be something we're talking about, and hopefully one day it will be something normal. But yeah, I think I'm going on a bit, but yeah, sorry. Hope that answers your question.
Thanks, Rose. The amazing thing about McDonald's as a target is that after their difficulties with activists in the 90s, they are shit scared of activists. And they, like, literally, we turned up in Leeds the other day, four of us put a table out and they closed the restaurant within about 5 minutes of us being there. They are that scared. So imagine what we could do if we all went. Was there a hand over here, someone? Cool. Hiya.
Thank you. Yeah, so obviously you guys are great. Like, I've seen you everywhere. Like, you're making, your movement is incredible. You're making such an immense change. And I'm just curious what your views are on sustainability and things. So obviously you're focused on animal rights. So is that primarily animal rights, or what are your views on sustainability? So factors such as fast fashion, sort of factors around that. So is it, like I say, is it primarily animal rights, or what are your views on sort of other vegan factors?
Yeah, well, we are not, we will allow anybody to join our organisation as long as they stick to our principles and values, which are shown on the right. Sorry. And these, if you're not a vegan, you could join us, but you'd hardly find anybody in Animal Rebellion that isn't a vegan, so we, you know, that's what we're like.
I think we touched this when we say that we are aiming to transition to a just and sustainable plant-based food system, because we acknowledge that just a plant-based food system may not necessarily be sustainable, and it has to be sustainable to combat the climate crisis, because we focus on animal justice via combating the climate crisis, given that animal agriculture and the fishing industry are the second greatest contributors to greenhouse gases. So we are primarily focused on combating climate change by banning animal agriculture and the fishing industries, and believe that it can be done only in a just and sustainable manner.
Hiya, you're right.
I think we can all agree in the room that we should move to a plant-based food system, of course, but how do we sell it to these mass organizations and companies that from a financial perspective, they can also gain a reason to move to this rather than just from a empathy reason, for the reasons that most of us have gone vegan for the, you know, for the well-being of the animals? How can we sell it to them from a financial perspective?
Thanks. Do you want to take that, Miranda?
Yeah, really good question. And the workers is actually something that we're trying to incorporate into our messaging, and something that we've been trying to think about more and more in our actions, because I think it can be easy to focus on like immediate changes and like animals and like the end goal that we want, but in reality there's thousands and thousands of people in this country who work in the animal agriculture industry who we can't just like shun off and you know, like reject in our move forward, because they're part of our population and we need them with us. You know, they're essential. They can be essential workers in a sustainable future if they can be retrained, and if they can, you know, they have skills to give to a sustainable plant-based food system that we could transition. The main issue is, of course, that the government and DEFRA are giving huge subsidies to the meat and dairy and the fishing industries instead of, you know, to plant-based farming. And there's some projects that are going on. I know there's some like quite grassroots organizations and companies that are working to transition, you know, animal farming into plant-based farming, or dairy farms into plant alternative, you know, making farms. And I think that is really essential, really. And although we're trying to push for the transition to a plant-based food system, the words just and sustainable, that just part really does need to mean for everybody, for all of the workers. And even if they have done things that we can deem, unacceptable and terrible, we are all part of a toxic system that all, at some point in our life, we've all done things I'm sure we all would never want to do now, and we have to bring those workers with us, and we're all in this together. And it is the people with the money and the power and the government with the subsidies who have the power to change. So that's why we're trying to target the companies who treat their workers so poorly, the slaughterhouses, who give their workers no rights, and the government who give all the money for this industry to exploit humans and non-human animals.
And we're under no illusion that these companies are just going to just decide to do this. We try to bring about enough discourse around the topic, and it's called Shifting the Overton Window, where we sort of change the range of ideas that are being discussed in the general public. Hiya.
Thank you. Okay, so I've got two questions, but before I ask my questions, I just want to say, one of the significant things that I noticed with this last action that you did with McDonald's, when you did it, after the action, you got global coverage all across the world speaking about McDonald's and how you guys disrupted that chain of restaurant, basically. And I think that's such a huge, significant thing to do, because it actually sent shockwaves all across the world, which is amazing. So my first question is, what results have you seen from the direct actions that you have been taking? Have you seen many changes? And the second question is, what can people do? Like, people who can't get involved in direct action, what can people do to put pressure on the institutions that you guys are taking direct action?
Rose, do you want to take that?
Yeah, thank you. Talking about the results from the last action, the press, the media coverage is a result. That's kind of what we're aiming for at the moment. We're not expecting McDonald's to go plant-based or to announce suddenly that they're going to go plant-based straight away. We're kind of hoping to start a conversation with them. Our strategies is to use similar to a group called Otpor from Serbia, kind of based on them, where it's basically ACT, so you do an action. Then from the momentum from the action, you recruit people. So that's kind of why we're here. And so we're recruiting people for the next action, which is the rebellion that's coming up. And then we train those people up and then to go back to ACT again. So it's about creating momentum and to mobilize more people to ACT, because we're pretty young. I think the group has only started a couple of years ago or something. So to be getting the amount of coverage that we're getting already, I think is pretty good. That's one of the main things we are trying to achieve with the actions at the moment. So it's just about getting a lot of coverage, as much coverage as you can, worldwide press, and getting the idea of a plant-based food system out there. And then also trying to recruit people and build this movement, because we really, really can't do it without numbers. We really need every single person in this room. There are many reasons why we're doing the actions. I mean, obviously, eventually the end goal is a plant-based food system, but we know that's not going to happen this year or next year. It's going to take a while. That's why we need loads of people on board. Basically press and mobilization are the main reasons we do actions at the moment. What was the other question? I think it was the second question.
How can they get involved?
Oh yeah, if you can't go to direct to actually take part in the actions. What was touched on earlier, at the moment, a lot of us are remote, working remotely. We all volunteer. So there's loads of ways you can get involved. We have social media teams, tech teams, or all the other teams, finance, arts. It's literally the same as any other charity or business. There's probably a team for whatever skills you have, and a lot of them do meet online. So that's like kind of like the at the national level, and then there are the local groups as well. So if you want to start a local group in your local area, you can start that by doing small actions in your town, or think as big as you like. And it could, or could be something as simple as going out postering. So putting up posters, Animal Rebellion posters all over your town just to get the message out there, and then hopefully people reach out to you too. But yeah, I think if you really want to start, then yeah, forming a local group is something that we really, really need more people to do. But yeah, if you want to join the national team, there are loads of remote roles as well. So yeah, visit our website and you can click get involved or something like that, and then yeah, fill in a form.
Hello. So my question was, why was the decision made to separate the Extinction Rebellion and the Animal Rebellion? Like, why are those two separate?
I can field that possibly. So basically, Extinction Rebellion exists to try and mobilize a mass movement of people. And unfortunately, they regard veganism as a something of a controversial topic. So they just won't touch it with a barge pole, which is a bit of an oversight for an environmental organization when they won't actually acknowledge the main cause of the problem. And they say that it's because they won't speak about solutions, which is kind of not true, because they do have XR farmers who propose solutions like regenerative farming that ultimately, if you look at the science, doesn't really work. So they propose solutions that don't work, but they won't actually necessarily touch a plant-based food system. And this was obviously highlighted to people in the movement at that time, and they felt that that they were missing a trick in terms of mobilizing vegans around this issue. But they were encouraged by XR effectively to set up a sister organization. It was going to be part of XR originally, but for various sort of internal politics reasons within XR, it couldn't be. So Animal Rebellion is a sister organization. We have an entirely separate structure, finances and everything like that. But we work alongside them as part of a movement of movements. We work alongside all sorts of groups. We're ultimately an intersectional movement. We care about Black Lives Matter. We care about all of these different movements that we work alongside, and they all utilize different tactics. And ultimately, we go out on the streets with XR whenever they're doing something, such as the rebellion on Monday. We have a coach leaving, so feel free to join us. And that's basically the reason why. Any other questions?
Hi guys, you mentioned earlier about the two-day school plan earlier. What have you been your main objections to the school plan, and what type of success rate are you seeing on the back end of schools taking this off?
Could you please repeat your question?
Yeah, so I would say, with regards to the two-day school plan, what are the main objections you're receiving from schools with regards to this, and what type of success rate are you seeing from schools with the uptake of this?
Yeah, that's a good question. So this campaign started about a year ago. It's currently running in 40 plus councils. The success, so we have a methodology in which we go about it. So once we find someone who wants to start a campaign in their council, the first step is researching on MPs within your council and finding their email IDs. And then we send out emails about why it's important to implement plant-based meals in schools. The response rate to our first batch of emails that we send is usually around 10%. So not the best, but we do get responses from MPs. We've had, although it's a fairly new campaign, just about a year, we've had quite a few successes. So Brighton is implementing one vegetarian day a week from October, so getting there. We've had a few successes with Leeds and Hackney, and we're in conversation. We work alongside ProVeg as well. So once our campaign reaches a place where MPs genuinely want to implement this in their local councils and want to take this to the implementation stage, we hand over to ProVeg, and ProVeg continues the final stages of the campaign of the actual implementation. So that's the trajectory we're on right now.
Thanks, Vania. Okay, we got one last question, so make it a doozy. Anyone got any questions? Ooh, there's one over there. Okay, you're making me run.
Hello. Hi. I was just wondering if you're completely volunteer-based or if you have paid roles, and also how you balance your normal life, like work, uni, whatever you do, with Extinction Rebellion, Animal Rebellion, because I'm a student and I haven't got any money and I need to focus a lot on my work, and I don't know how to balance both parts, and it's so important to do it, but I don't know how much I need to do, and yeah, just wondering how you balance it all, basically.
Thanks. Anyone want to take that?
I'm happy to take that. Yeah, we are a voluntary organisation. We do help people with lots of things like train fares and things like that. There's ways of people claiming money from the state. So I forget what it's called. Universal credit. I'm a pensioner, so I don't get universal credit. But people are voluntary. The organisation pays for a house, and people can stay in the house. And generally, you sign up as a volunteer. Anyone else? Yeah.
I'm a student at uni, and this summer I've taken on more. And in the summer, you can get some financial support from the movement if you do if you're consistent and you're doing work for the movement, four or five times a week, you can get finance. But also throughout second year, I just did a few meetings a week voluntary, and I managed that okay, because for me, because if it's something you really want to do, I think it's easier because you enjoy it and it's less work. But obviously, I completely understand the stuff we have to do at uni, plus then getting a job plus volunteering is crazy. It doesn't always work. So I think the local groups is actually kind of the best way if you want to get involved, because you can do things in person, or joining one team that you actually really, enjoy, arts if you like that, or social media if you like that, or messaging or whatever, because then you can just kind of do it. And it's not as, stressful. But it can be a lot with uni, but also if you're passionate, it can be, amazing opportunity to meet, great people as well. So, yeah, I wouldn't be scared away.
Thanks, Miranda. Cool. All right, that brings us to the end. So before we go, I should try and sort of upsell you some various things that are on the horizon. So as we've mentioned, we've got the Rebellion coming up from Monday the 23rd. Yeah, for 2 weeks. So we're going to be down in London, along with XR and various other groups, creating a bit of a ruckus. We have a whole itinerary of fun planned. So if you fancy getting involved, come and talk to us over the big pile of sticks that we have on the corner over there. We're surrounded by yellow flags. We've got the Animal Rights March on the 28th, which we will be leaving from Smithfield Meat Market. Do we have a time for that? Meeting at 12:30. Cool. And so we're going to have a march around London. It's going to be lots of fun, thousands of people, hopefully. We're going to be stopping at various evil companies on the way around and giving them a piece of our mind. And then we're going to be possibly having something a little bit fun after that as well, which I can't talk about. But if anybody wants to get involved, we've got our social media. Have a look on our website, follow us on all the usual social media sites, or just come and chat to us over there. We've got volunteer forms, sign-up forms, and all of that good stuff. And we'll hope to see you on the streets of London really soon. Thank you, guys.